Okay.
With KiCad.
Okay, this is my topic, why and how to switch to KiCad. Because the idea is, let everybody start to use KiCad. So it is targeted to Eagle users, but you can compare. So first thing is, we pronounce it as KiCad, because this Chris Gamo, he started to push KiCad very vigorously, and he pronounced it as KiCad, but actually, the real pronunciation should be KiCad. I call it to French, but our two usual French guys are not here. Yeah, is it? KiCad, yeah. So, but many people call this KiCad, so it's interchangeable. So, why I choose KiCad? I have been using Altium when I have access. Now I don't have access, so I don't use Altium. And I have been playing for several years of Eagle, then I switched to KiCad. There are several reasons. One is I don't want to be limited. Just while Kimin just talking about the free version of Eagle, there are some size limitation and the layer limitation. Although the limitation is quite okay to work with, but I think if I'm going longer, I want to do bigger board, I want to do more layers, then maybe from start I should start to use a very freely available tool. So this is the first reason I'm using. And second one is, I cannot afford any pay software. It's quite expensive, especially even Eagle for the hobbyist license is about $600, is it? Yeah, this is about $100. But you cannot use it for commercial purpose. That's the problem. So that's why I cannot afford anything, so I just use the KiCad because it's usable. And most importantly, I want to share my design. This is a very debatable point. Because many people are working on open source designs and they want to share their design. But if your audience, the people download your file, they don't have the software to open, it will be a very bad experience. Although sometimes you can publish a PDF file, but for these people, if they want to recreate your design, they want to improve your design, they have to redraw everything using their own tool. It's kind of not very nice. It kind of reward everything. So that's why KiCad is actually very good for this point, and this is why it start to be popular among the open source community. Okay, so some of the misperceptions, because there are so many comments over the internet comparison with Eagle, and there's so many years of you can just go and search. There are too many. Some are correct. Some are correct at the moment when the article is written, but what I'm talking about now is as per current. But may not be truly accurate because I have not been using Eagle for several years. So this is what my last impression of Eagle and my current impression of KiCad. Not very fair, but just some of the idea. The first thing is that many people are complaining about the KiCad is not very stable for a very professional design. It is not just a major software open source community. To debunk this, you just take a look at this Michael Osman's Daisho project. I just show this. Let me. Okay, we just see the PCB. I don't want to see the shoulder. Okay, this is the project. This is an 8-layer board, USB 3, FPGA. On everything. It's like that. It's a huge VGA chip in the middle, and actually you can see. A 3D preview of the board. It's super huge board, and it's actually everything is designed in KiCad. Okay, we continue. Second. There's also some impression of KiCad is into an endless development, and many people are talking about how to use a tool called KiBuilder to build your own KiCad from the source, and especially from like a snapshot version of everyday, like the kind of tutorial all over on the internet, and they claim that this is the only usable version. And I feel that's not the truth. Actually, there's a recently very, very recent stable version, which is 4.0.2. They start to release this regularly because before that, an older version is kind of 2013. So until now, they have a newly usable version, it's 4.0.2. It actually starts with 4.0, but now it's 4.0.2. You can download from this website, their own official website. There's a Mac version, Windows version, and Linux version, and under recent Ubuntu, you can just do a apt-get. It is already in the official source. So there's actually many people say it's not stable, yeah, but for me, it crashes much less than iTunes. I may encounter some crash like once a week, that kind of frequency. But there's a lot of annoying here and there. Later I will do a demo, you will start to see some of the small little teething problems, but it's still workable because you pay zero. You really cannot complain too much things about it because it's free. Okay, now it's the real comparison. Against Ego, there are several things that Ego cannot do. One is it can do a hierarchical schematic, which means if you have a very big schematic, you can separate this into sections, and each section is a small schematic. Whereas in Ego free version, there you can only do one schematic. Okay, there's no limitation on the size of layers. You can do whatever layer you want, like 6 layer, 8 layers, and it has built-in 3D view, which I show later. And one thing is, I feel much like TiCad is it allows you to see freely editing any of the PCB footprints on the board itself. We will show them something like later. Okay, maybe it's good to show an example. So there are some advantages of course there are some UI annoyances, very headache. Sometimes you have to close the whole program and start again. Then you overcome some of the strange, like a cursor missing, the kind of things. It happens all the time. And the library collection is not as huge as Ego, although it is improving, but yeah.
Sorry, what is the PCB?
Okay, it's the packaging of the components. Let me give an example. For example, this is a capacitor. This is we call it a footprint. It's made of two pads and the tube screen of this particular thing. What I mean comparing Ego is normally this thing is in a library, and when it's in a library, you cannot change it. Whereas in TiCad, you can change it any way you want. I'll show this later. Okay, this built-in 3D view is really nice. This is the board I recently designed. This is it's up in manufacture. Okay. We can talk this later. Yeah. So okay, the TiCad workflow is a little bit different from Ego, if you are very familiar with Ego. But it's actually quite similar to the older style CAD system, like ORCAD. I'm not sure how many people are actually using that. I'm using that like 1990s or something. It's very old DOS machine. It's similar to this workflow. Whereas there are several components in Ego, in TiCad. The main thing is called EE Schema. It is a schematic design tool that you use to draw your schematic. Supporting the EE schema, there's a library editor that you edit your components or your parts. Okay. There's a medium tool called CVPCB. It's quite a strange name. I don't know what it stands for. It is used to assign a footprint to a symbol. This is completely different from Ego. I'll explain more later. And after this all done, you have to generate a .NET file. And this file will open by a PCB editor. It's called PCB New. It's kind of a fed up name. If my programmer give a name PCB New, I will fire him immediately. But it's kind of historic reason that this is somehow called PCB New. And with a PCB New, there's another portion called a PCB Footprint Editor that you use to design your footprint for a particular component. And after all, it gives it outputs a Gerber file and it has a Gerber view. So it's kind of a whole ecosystem all in one package. we do a demo, it should be much easier to understand everything. So let me start by... Okay, I already have my demo. Because the CatCat, you need to use a lot of hotkeys, so I use this program that I type in it, you can see what I'm typing on the keyboard. So now it's annoyance number one. I double click the schematic file, nothing come up. Actually, it is already running, but it's at the back. So I already did the schematic. It's quite a simple schematic. It's to transistor everything, to capacitor, whatever. All the components are actually here under this place component part. You press here, you add here. So here are all the built-in libraries with all the components. There's one particular concept which is different from Ego is that a component is a component. It doesn't know which footprint it uses. For example, this is a resistor. A resistor can be any type of package. It can be 0805, 0603, or a true hole, whatever. It can be any component, but CatCat doesn't design it. It decides this in a library. So it just draw a resistor, that's it. For people who are switching from Ego, you will feel it's quite strange why you have to do that. After I use it for several months, I feel actually it's very good property because when this particular component is not in the built-in library, I can draw my own without drawing a footprint, so I can put in first. And maybe later I can assign to a footprint which already exists. So that's one of the very good properties. So how to give this, say, okay, if I want a true hole resistor for this particular part, I put my cursor here and press E. Okay, it has a reference, it has value. Footprint now is empty. What I do is I assign footprint. So here comes up all the footprint library. You can see, let's see a resistor. Can go all the way to resistor to hold. For example, I can use this one. This can be a footprint for a resistor. Now I want to use this one, and you can see the annoying again, it doesn't pop up. It's at the back. Okay, it's on the PCB, it's something like this. For certain parts, it actually has a built-in 3D model for the thing. For example, here. When you have a model, you can see the component itself. So it looks quite nice. But for some of the footprint, it doesn't have a built-in 3D model. So I assign here. Done. This is how I take a component and assign a footprint for this one. So this is one of the way to do that. The other way is using CVPCB, which is here. It will kind of load up all your components and give you all the libraries, and you can just assign in this screen. This is E1 100 micro capacitor. I can find here. I see capacitor to hold. Sorry. Then I can find the. Maybe I use this one. So you can do this as a batch because it's sorted like all the resistors are together. So you just sort one by one. Just double click to simply. You click through everything that is assigned together, just save it. So okay, we have this schematic. And in order to make a PCB, just now I mentioned you need a netlist file, which is here. The general netlist. Okay, now you can open the PCB editor. See this one. I already have this in, but the way to do that is you click the net, load the netlist. It will load every footprint here. You can test it, see if anything missing. Then it will be all here. So you can see these are the all the layers that this board has. It's a quite a strange naming, but normally you can take look at the pop-up notes and you know what happens or what it actually means. Front copper layer, bottom copper layer, like a handset not really used, only for SMD process. Paste is solder paste. This is your screen. This is solder mask or whatever. All kind of. It's a little bit of strange naming. I have a slide to try to summarize what it actually is. You can take a look and compare with Ego. Actually, it's a one-to-one correspondence. Because basically they are the same thing. So now we start to lay out the board. It's actually very simple. You just this part is just as easy as Ego. It's just you just you see all the fly wires. These are not connected yet. You just do your magic, like do whatever you like. Maybe I spend 1 minute to finish this board. Okay, there's a difference from what Kimin just showed now is the design rule check is real-time. What does it mean is, for example, if I have this wire, I go through here, just like that, I will have a problem here. I cannot go through all this. Doesn't look very nice here. I cannot go through. It doesn't let me to draw over another track. So only valid one will be able to, you will be able to draw this out. But the color doesn't look very nice. Okay, almost finished. We have two left, two wire. I've got another layer. Okay, actually this board is like that. It's finished already. You can take a look at this board. You can even do a 3D view of this board. You see all the components, and actually this is very important. If you want to see the clearance of the between components, you don't want to overlap all these. This is very important. And there's another script that you can export the 3D model to like a step file or some kind of a 3D model that you can import into a mechanical CAD. Then you can design the case around it. And of course, we can do a few of rock playing that makes it even nicer. You cannot measure the height. Height is built in the model, but you can measure any 2 points of this board exactly here. The way to do this is you put a starting point, then you press space, then you see it becomes 0, 0. Then whenever you move, it tells you how much distance you have traveled. So it's very easy to measure distance on the board. Okay, just now I also mentioned that you can easily modify this footprint on the PCB. And actually, if you can go to Google, you type in Ego modify pads. You will soon find like a fourth or fifth resource and say how to modify holes and the pads on Ego without dying. But in CAD it's so simple that you can point to one pad, you just press E, edit, tell you I want to edit this pad. You can do whatever you like. You can say I want to dig a hole. Or it's too big. Okay. Then it becomes a bigger hole. You can put here, you say I want to move it. Oh sorry, you move the hole. Okay. You can right click on the footprint, you say you want to edit with footprint edit editor. It comes out here, you can move it around. And you can just go here, update footprint in current board. That will move here. By doing this, you are not changing the library. The library still can still intact. So you can do whatever you want on the board when the component is already on the board. So with this one, it becomes so easy to do everything. Like for example, I want this silk screen to move in. I think Eagle, you have to explode this footprint, then you can do this. Yeah, or you need to do that in the library. You can do this, you can move everything around, whatever you like. So now you have a very nice 3D view with everything. Then once you think it is nicely done, you save it, you do a plot. This is same as the Gerber generation, but it's a little bit manual process. It's not like Ego, you can do. Many people, if they give a CAM file, that you can do this automatically. Here, you still have to do it manually. That you need to give out. You say, I want to export all these layers. Maybe I need margin, I need shoulder mask, I need the edge. Okay, I plot. And geo file. So after this, you go to the in your own directory. You have all these Gerber files here. Then it has a built-in Gerber viewer. You can load Gerber file. I want this. Okay, I think there's too many files here in the moment. Let me delete it first. The annoyance, it never open up, have to do manually. So these are the files you give manufacturer. What they will do, they will check the file if it's good. They will see you have all these files. This is the backside of copper. This is the backside solder mask, so that within this mask, there's no paint. Elsewhere there's a paint, so you can see this individually. So you can check by yourself, and you can see this is the chip screen. This is the edge for the board. This is the front side shoulder mask. And the front side shoulder screen. And the drill, you can see if the drill all matches onto the pack. Then after this, you just pack this everything, then send out to one of the choice of your manufacturer partner. So okay, the went to almost there, but at least some of the good resources for TICAD, especially this guy's Chris Gamos, Contact Electronics. I actually can go to his YouTube channel. He made a whole series of tutorial on how to use TICAD. Last time it was based on a previous version, but all the concepts remain the same. And there's a forum also set up by Chris, and there's a lot of libraries everywhere. And especially for the TICAD footprint library, you can take a look at the footprint library. It's actually based on GitHub. So whenever you want to update, you just go here, you say GitHub, then it will start to populate all the libraries available on there, then you just pull it down. So it will automatically generate. It keeps updating, like every 3-4 days there are some updating on there. So it's kind of very up-to-date and very nice to use. But these are all footprints. The schematic library is not very up-to-date, but this one is very leading edge, and also including all the 3D shapes. But you can also write your own, do your own 3D, make your own 3D model, but using a very old program called Win3D, it's very anti-human kind of software. I hate it very much. Okay, so that's about the everything. So tutorial. Oh yeah, yeah. There's a website called CircuitHub. You can sign up to this website, and it has a lot of people contributing all kinds of component libraries onto CircuitHub, and you can export into any format like Eagle, like Kaka, like Altium, all kinds of formats. You can just export from the CircuitHub, and it will kind of save the file into your Dropbox all the time. So it is actually very useful. Okay, so that's everything about Kaka.
Okay, like, the way
Kaka
is designed seems like a very unique
style
of the VR. Like, one small program do something, then
cut
the result to another program.
Exactly. Exactly. This is, okay. You see all the things here at the main screen, there are so many, these buttons, these are all individual programs. And normally we use the first five. And there are some very useful thing as well, like this one, TCP calculator. Actually, it's hugely useful. It's kind of, for example, the basic thing, it gives you a regulator calculating, and you want how many volt, informable volt, or it gives you how many, what kind of phase value. You can calculate the resistance of the case well as well. It gives a width, gives a thickness, gives a length, it gives you how many ohms it is. And the isolation spacing if you're working on some high voltage PCBs. And this is a kind of impedance calculation. RF attenuator, resistor color code. And even all the board class values, the minimum this clearance, all these things. They give all the values here. You can just use this. Actually, it's a very handy kind of tool here.
I got two questions.
Yeah.
First one is design rules. How do you
look
for any
values? There's a design rule here. So you can say what is your clearance, set width, height, whatever. You can actually specify here. You can have multiple design classes of rules, then you assign different nets to different classes. And also global, you can say how wide is your traces, or you can say you need to specify here, then when you do a tracing, it will appear here. Otherwise, it doesn't appear here.
Then the next question is, let's say if I update something in the schematic, right? Then how do I, like, okay, after I did transition to port?
Yeah, I know what you mean. You are pinpointing the pain of TechCAD.
Oh, okay.
You have to do, after you modify something on the schematic, you have to regenerate an analyst. Then you go to the PCB side, you read this again. When reading, it will ask if your footprint has been changed, do you keep or change? Extra ones, do you delete? All these kind of things. You have to do this manually every time. It is actually very frustrating if you have to switch in and back from these two programs. Oh, my suggestion is get a very good mouse and get a big screen. Either get a big screen or get two screens so that you can have PCB on one screen and the schematic on the other. Because once you click here, some of the components here, it will automatically move the cursor there. So it's much easier for you to. Eagle, I can do this one. I think this is very, very important.
Maybe one last question for
For a
program
for base design, what tool?
I didn't use the plugin. There's a plugin called Step Up. I heard it gives a IDF file output. IDF, I think it is. I'm not sure because some people say they expect a step output, but many they are. The Kaka team actually is working on the step output, and they have some demo version somewhere put on the internet, but it is not officially including this yet. But I feel there's still some distance for this to be true, because currently all the 3D models are based on VIML, so it's basically a mesh based model. It's not a solid base, so I guess there's still some distance to work around.
Thank you, Karshan.